Oh, Robert Wagner, I am just so glad you are on our show.
Thank you.
And you brought your co-stars from Heart to Heart. Stephanie Powers is here and Lionel Stander. It's so exciting.
And we have Freeway with us, too.
Freeway, oh, yeah.
Thank you so much for having us.
You know, I am so happy that you're bringing Heart to Heart back. Being the creative person that I am, you know, I have a story idea for one of your TV movies.
Oh, great.
Yeah. Jonathan Hart rescues a TV talk show host, and of course, I would play the talk show host.
Of course. Yeah.
Could I ask you a favor?
Sure.
Do you think maybe we could run over my ending just to kind of see how it would play?
Oh, yeah. What are my lines?
Well, you just kind of ad-lib, just kind of go with it. Here, hold me. Oh, Jonathan, thank you so much for rescuing me.
That's a hell of an ending. What happened before this?
Who cares? Kisser. Yep.
You really kiss great.
Listen, if you're there, I ain't gonna fool around. You don't get those golden opportunities that often, you know? May I call you RJ?
Please.
What does the J stand for?
John.
Robert John. I don't know quite how to put this. I am a longtime fan of yours. And when I think back over your career, it's not really anything. Heart to Heart sticks out, probably because it's. We all love that so much. But I'm a fan more of your style, I would say.
Oh, thank you.
And your longevity. To what do you attribute your style? Where did it come from? Like, just your demeanor and the way you dress and the way you carry yourself. It's different than...
Well, you know, Vicki, I think we all sort of steal from everybody, don't we?
Who'd you steal from?
Well, I had a lot of people to look up to, do you know? Fred Astaire.
No, but you grew up around him, didn't
mm-hmm.
you?
Yeah, when I was a kid, I went to school with his son. So I was around Fred Astaire for a long time.
Was he just as stylish off as
Absolutely.
On? Yeah.
He used to pick me up from school, put me in his car, and I'd go to his house, and I never knew that he was Fred Astaire. I mean, you know, I didn't know as a kid that he was this fantastic talent and all
yeah.
of that. Wonderful, wonderful man. I was really blessed to have him as a friend.
Now, how did you grew up in, you were born in Detroit, right?
Yes, I was born in Michigan.
So how'd you get from Detroit to Fred Astaire's house?
My family moved out here mm-hmm. to California, and we lived very near a golf club. And the minute I saw these motion picture stars going by, I said, oh, I want to be an actor. That's what I want to be. I want to be one of them.
Was this much to your parents' chagrin?
Yes, they didn't like that at all.
What'd they want you to be when you grew up?
Well, my father was in the steel business, and he wanted me to follow in his footsteps and become Robert J. Wagner and Son. And so I... great odds, you know, I kept saying, no, I want to be an actor. And they said, no, that's out. You know, the longevity is for the... You don't have any kind of... The fatality rate is very big, and we want you to follow in this business. And I'd go back every year and work in the steel mills and all that sort of stuff. I said, no, I don't want to be an actor.
Who'd you look up to, acting-wise?
Well... very much towards Clark Gable. I used to wait for Clark Gable. I caddied for him for a long time. And Spencer Tracy. And I used to do a lot of impersonations. And I've told this story a few times. But I used to do a lot of impersonations. And a friend of mine said to me, you know, I know this young kid. That's me. And he said, I think he's wonderful and he's got a great, great chance to, and he wants to be in the motion picture business. Can I send him out? So there was this wonderful casting director called Sally Baiano at Warner Brothers Studios, and I went out to Warner's, and I went in there, and Sally said to me, well, what can you do? And I said, well, I can do Cary Grant.
Well, let's hear Cary Grant.
Jimmy
Stewart.
Can
you do it?
Yeah, I'll give you a little bit of that later. Not right away.
You're going to tease me.
Yeah.
He's a good kisser, but he's a tease.
I did Cary Grant, Jimmy Stewart, Clark Gable. I did a bunch of impersonations. So I did all these impersonations, you know? Mm-hmm. And he said, well, we have all of those people. We know who they are. What about doing you, you know? Mm-hmm. And I was so scared I ran out of the office, you know?
So now can we hear Cary Grant?
Cary Grant. How would you like to have... You know, there's a lot of people that do Cary Grant. I did Cary Grant once for Cary Grant.
What did he say?
He said to me, he said, I understand you do me. And I said, yes, I do. And he said, well, then do me. And I said, well, I'm doing you now. You know, can't help it, you know, it was one of those kind of things. Yeah. I've done...
That was pretty good.
Done.
Very impressive.
I wish you'd have been in Sally's office. That'd have been great.
Now, who took you under their wing?
Spencer Tracy.
Spencer Tracy.
I did a picture with him, and he asked me to play his son. And, you know, I was knocking around in Hollywood. I mean, it was all this, you know, there was a lot of guys that were, you know, kicked in after the war. And I was under contract to Fox. I worked as an extra for a year. And then I got under contract to Fox. And I was doing, a lot of war pictures were being made then.
Mm-hmm.
And Spence asked for me to play his son. And... it was really the biggest break I had. You know, it was a wonderful break. And he really put his arm around me and he said, you know, you can go someplace. And it made a big difference. You know, we all have that in our lives. You know, somebody comes into our life at some time. It's either an uncle or a friend that you meet somewhere that says, hey, you can be great. It's away from your family a bit. Don't you find that?
Now did he? Yes. Mm. Well, yeah, we all know who took me under her wing. What did Spencer teach you? Did she teach you a lot about acting? I mean, because I...
Well, you know, I thought I could learn.
He was very professional,
yeah,
wasn't he?
Yeah, you know, and I'd watch him. He was so natural. And I would ask him, how do you do that? You know, I mean, I thought I could learn how to do that the way you play a game, you know, the mm-hmm. way you play a sport or how, you know. And he really didn't... You know, I think he just took those characters into himself and let them happen. You know, he had a lot of self-confidence and...
So is that... what you learned about acting from these guys is that less is more?
Yeah, I think less is more, and to try to be your own man. I had a hard time getting over that, you know, because I was so, as I told you, you know, doing so many people and being what I thought I was supposed to be instead of doing me.
Just being
and
natural.
And so Sally Baiano gave me a real good piece of advice to say, you know, be yourself, do you.
What do you think's the secret to your longevity?
Oh, I think...
Because you can count, like, on one hand, actors that have gone from series to series to series to series, mm-hmm. that have stayed around forever.
Well, I think you have to have a lot of luck, you know, really, and kind of know when that's there. I've been around an awful lot of good people, you know. Really, I've been very lucky because I've had a lot of wonderful women to work with, and a leading man is made through women. And I've worked with a lot of wonderful, wonderful actresses. And, you know, I worked with Audrey Hepburn and Elizabeth Taylor and Jacqueline Smith and Barbara Stanwyck and Sophia Loren. And, I mean, you know, I've really been very, very blessed by all of that.
Yeah, you are a lucky son of a gun.
And now I've worked with you.
Now I know. I think it's my first on-screen kiss, actually.
This is a great idea.
I may have to put this in my resume.
This is a great idea. Talk show hostess.
This is the great thing about having your own talk show. You say, bring Robert Wagner over and write me a kissing scene. This is the great thing about having your own talk show, you see.
So sweet.
How about the chemistry that you and Stephanie have? Was that instantaneous?
Well, do you know, I've known Stephanie for a long time. I mean, she was dancing on West Side Story. And my late wife, Natalie, you know, did that, mm-hmm. Musical, and I remembered Stephanie, and then we worked together.
I didn't know
later.
Stephanie was a gypsy.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know that.
She's a gypsy, all right.
Instant chemistry between you guys? First time on the set?
Yeah, I always felt really terrific about her. I mean, every time I was, you know, I mean, I just felt really had a... And I always felt that she had a great sense to play this character, which a lot of people, you know, I mean, how you get can get... pigeonholed in this business, you know, and get typed. I don't think that they realize that she had this fantastic talent because this girl can do so many things. I mean, she can do everything. I mean, she's absolutely marvelous, you know.
Well, let's quit talking about her and bring her out.
I'm all for that.
Y'all first fell in love with her as the sexy secret agent who could mix it up with the big boys in The Girl from U.N.C.L.E., and although I personally fell in love with her in Palm Springs Weekend, but that's another story. And later you've loved her as the loving wife and elegant sleuth, Jennifer Hart. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Stephanie Powers.
Basket. I must have thrown away thousands of papers. It was amazing how much I didn't know.
Not knowing what to throw away is part of getting the job done right.
I wonder.
C, B, and J, E forever.
Mm-hmm.
I know about the J-E, it's the C-G I never heard of. Must be quite a memory.
Yes, it was. Oh, but darling, that was a long time before I met you.
With me today is one of my favorite TV men, Robert Wagner, and also joining us is his co-star and friend of many years, the beautiful and talented Stephanie Powers. You know, you guys were sort of unceremoniously canceled there right out from under our things, weren't you? How many years ago now?
And from under our things.
How many years ago was this now? Jog our memories.
When was it canceled? It was canceled.
Like 9 or 10 years ago.
10 years ago.
10 years ago. But, and you guys
and you're right.
had
it
no
wasn't.
Idea that they were going to do this, right?
No.
I was in Paris doing Mr. All's Daughter, a miniseries, and it was a Sunday night, and it was the Sunday before the Monday that ABC and all the networks traditionally would go to New York and announce the fall lineup. And we had no idea that we weren't on it. And RJ called me and said, we're not on it.
What happened? What do you think happened? Can you ever figure out that network politics?
No, jump in there. You're doing fine.
I'd like you to explain network politics.
Well, sometimes what happens is they bring in someone else, a new president and a new group, and they want to have, there's only so many time slots, and they want to put their own things on. And that's exactly what happened with us. They felt that we had been on for 5 years. He wanted to put something else in there. We were the 12th most viewed show in the United States, and we were syndicated in 86 or 89 countries, and we were having such a wonderful time doing this show, and all of a sudden it just stopped.
It's what is it about the Harts you think that everybody loves so much? What made us
it's
love
a
you
form,
guys?
You know, it's a format that's worked, you know, before. And I think that, well, you know, we worked very hard on being monogamous. And I never looked at another woman on the show, and she was never involved with another man. And it was a love affair. And I think that the public really felt that, and they wanted that.
We all lived vicariously.
Yeah, but I think that
and there were no kids. That was great. No teenagers
well,
to deal with.
We couldn't very well do. I mean, people used to write letters when we didn't take the dog with us. So can you imagine what they would have said if we didn't take the kid?
Did you ever get any flack from the networks about them wanting to change the way you guys were?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Sure.
We want you to have a baby, or we want you to have a...
Always wanted us to have a baby. You know?
How'd you handle all that
stuff? Well, we actually had a wonderful... a wonderful show
young girl,
for the...
That young girl wrote it up in Bakersfield, sent it to us.
Yeah, a fan.
Yeah.
A fan. It was a wonderful story that was going to be a two-parter about Jennifer getting pregnant and about all those preparations to have the baby and all this sort of stuff. And then when she was having lunch with some of her girlfriends, one of her girlfriends was the object of a hit. Jennifer, it was mistaken identity. And Jennifer was literally hit by a car, which in effect was meant for her girlfriend. And of course lost the baby and was in the hospital.
But you guys never did that script.
We never did that scene.
That was on for the following season. We had written a script and...
So we never got to see
and
that.
Max and I were doing
Would
it.
Would you like to see that one?
So now...
Oh, well, we can probably...
I don't... Yeah, I'd like to see it
probably
back.
Probably do that one.
I'd like
to
see it back.
You like
on
it?
You two, it's kind of ironic that you both suffered such similar tragedies in your personal lives almost simultaneously.
Yes.
You were with William Holden for nine years. You were how far into your second marriage with Natalie?
We had been married for, I think, 8 years, yeah.
And the accidents happened, what, within two weeks of each other or something?
Yes,
Was that, how was that for you? Did you help each other through that?
It's a pretty difficult time.
Well,
very difficult, I would think.
And we went to work very soon after.
Do you know, Stephanie was really wonderful to me because... I had a very difficult time getting up and going again, and the children had gone back to school, and I felt, you know, that if they were making that effort, that I would go back. I had to go back to work, and so she was there, and the crew was there, and we just started, you know, and I just started trying to get through it, and she was trying to get through it, and that was, you know, it was, I don't know how to explain it, but I mean, it was wonderful to have a friend like Stephanie there to help me. And
a very odd set of circumstances. I'm sure you'll agree that accidents should happen that cause the loss of your mate so closely together, especially with people that are working together. So it's a very unusual set of circumstances, and I don't think that there's any classic answer for how we managed to cope with it.
Any regrets about never marrying William Holden?
Oh, well, we had both been married unsuccessfully. He quite a few years longer than mine was. Mm-hmm. And I think it was at a time when we didn't want to have to qualify our love or our being together by being married. I never realized how complicated that was going to be until he died. Because I had no rights at all.
But you're still very, very active in the William Holden
Wildlife. Well, in the William Holden Wildlife Foundation, and then I also became involved with the Game Ranch, mm-hmm. And actually sort of took over his position in the Game Ranch, which he had started in 1960, where we currently carry on breeding 37 species of wild animals. And Bill had always wanted to carry on and actually back up that specific animal preservation with an education system, because clearly without education, it's meaningless, you know, it's just temporary. And I think he'd be very proud of what's been accomplished, because I think it far exceeds any of our ideas of what we would be creating and what we would be, the need that we would be answering. Yeah. We've got 10,000 students a year coming through that facility.
That's great, yeah. We have to take a break. Maybe such a nice time talking to these people, but don't you guys go anywhere, because we're going to talk to RJ and Stephanie about the new people in their lives, and we're going to find out whether their on-screen chemistry ever spilled over into their real lives when we come back.
An automobile accident.
I'm sorry, darling.
Eleanor Biddlecombe, isn't that the woman you used to work for back at the newspaper and what's-its-face?
Kingman's Ferry. She was more than just someone I used to work for, Max. She was my teacher, my mentor. I learned more from Biddy in 1 year than I learned from 6 years in college.
You met Eleanor, Max. Don't you remember when Jennifer's book was first published at the signing?
Oh, yeah. guy, that good-looking, feisty broad at the front of the line who demanded a free copy.
I remember that. She said she shouldn't have to pay because she invented me.
I tried to get a telephone number. Couldn't score.
To Robert Wagner and Stephanie Powers about their lives and about their television comeback as Jonathan and Jennifer Hart. Their new movie is called Home is Where the Heart Is, and it airs tomorrow night as part of the NBC Friday Night Mystery Series. So now, how are the Harts going to be updated for the 90s? Any changes, major changes in your characters?
Well, you know, one of the principal changes is that it's a two-hour format, which allows us to develop the relationship a little bit more. You know, in an hour show, it's only really about 47 minutes of film, and you have to get the plot in there and the guest stars in there and all of this. So now we have a little more air to breathe, and I think we're having more fun with it, I think.
Yeah. On the first show, you know, we had to reintroduce our characters and bring Max back in with us. You know, Lionel Standers back with us, and we have a whole new audience, so we had to kind of let them know what we were like before. But this one that you've been seeing the clips of is an interesting one because Jennifer, inherits a town.
A town?
Yeah, she inherits a town. So we go to this wonderful little town. We get involved with all these very, very interesting people.
It's a wonderful franchise that the Harts have because they can pretty much do. I mean, there are so many things that the Harts can do that we can't do.
Are they still incredibly?
We'd like to do.
They're still incredibly wealthy. Yes.
Yes, but it's not
that's
not the main point. I mean, Jonathan is a self-made man, mm-hmm. a phenomenon that can only happen in America. He's a fellow who was an orphan, picked up from an orphanage on the street by Max, who gave him an education, and he became who he became. And the two of them together live a rather fascinating life, and by way of the virtue of the things that they're interested in or curious about, it leads them, or their past lives, lead them to these adventures. But I always say that that things happen to the Harts that couldn't happen to anybody else. But isn't that nice?
Yeah. whose idea was Heart to Heart? I mean, did somebody deliberately pattern that after The Thin Man? Because it's so reminiscent of Nick and Nora Charles. And
yes, I stole it.
Did you?
So Heart to Heart was your
idea? It's RJ's
idea. Was it?
Well, and Tom Mankiewicz wrote the script for Steffi and I, and he titled it Heart to Heart, and Sidney Sheldon created the first part of it, and then we had some writers. Mart Crowley came in, and he wrote a lot of the stories, and we had this idea of doing this couple, and we thought that maybe this would be the right time for it, mm-hmm. and Steph was involved, and we were involved in putting the sets together and all that sort of thing.
Was she your first and only choice to
Absolutely.
Be Mrs. Hart?
Uh-huh. Yeah, the only one.
Now, you guys were single a long time in there. Did anything
single a long time in
there,
work?
You know, where you when you were working together, and did anything ever?
Yeah,
no, but not really.
Nothing? Never even crossed your mind?
RJ wasn't single.
I mean, she's a very beautiful lady. She's pretty darn cute. Never
RJ
crossed your mind?
RJ and Jill were together for...
Yeah, but there were several cars parked in Stephanie's driveway, you know?
But there was never any sort of temptation for that on-screen chemistry to sort of go back into one of the dressing rooms or anything?
No, I think Jill was watching. Very good. Jill was always there watching.
Jill was in there this whole time? Now, you're married to Jill St. John for how long now?
It will be 4 years this May.
Did you have a hard time taking the plunge again? Because you two dated for a long time, didn't you?
Yeah, we would. I'd known Jill for a long time. Mm-hmm. And we dated, for about 8 years, and then we got married.
Hard to make that decision to get married again?
Not really, no, it wasn't so difficult.
No?
It wasn't so difficult.
You seem to sort of be attracted to redheads.
Yes, seem to be.
Sure.
But,
yes, you're...
you're
flanked by them.
I'll give you 30 minutes to stop holding my hand. And you're recently a newlywed as well, yes?
Mm-hmm.
To tell us who and what and where and when and
why. He's not in the business. In fact, he's not even in the country. A perfect marriage. We don't live together. It's great.
Who did you marry?
I married a Frenchman. He lives in France.
But now you globetrot a lot, though, don't you? You go to France, you're over there in Kenya, you're...
Yeah, she's...
I got a lot of frequent flyer miles.
She's, you too, and you're both, you're into horses.
We travel a lot, you know. We've been on the road together. We've been around the world, practically, you know.
Together?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I think we've
And this is okay with the spouses and everything.
Oh, yeah.
Because I would not be okay with my spouse.
Well, you know, let me tell you, Jill, Jill and Stephanie were friends when they were younger, and they've known each other. We've all, you know, we've all been sort of...
You've grown
in
up
this,
together.
Yeah, in this together. But it's been such a wonderful relationship to have someone like Stephanie in my life, you know, such a great friend, and we've done so much work together, and we share a lot together.
You both have horses in common, too.
Uh-huh. Well, they don't live together.
You... No, but they do trot around the globe together.
Well, yeah.
You have quarter horses?
I raise quarter horses, rodeo horses, cutting horses.
Do you do that stuff? Do you cut and all that stuff?
Yeah.
My ex-husband gave me a cutting horse for Christmas once. Some bitch threw me and almost killed me.
Yeah?
I think that was his plan, actually. I got on that horse, he took off running down that pasture, and he was chasing a car. Got to the end of the pasture, he stopped, and I didn't.
Maybe he just wanted to get out there and pick you up, you know?
And you raise, what, thoroughbreds?
Oh, I've got different things. I play polo, and so does my husband. So we have quite a lot of polo ponies. You need quite a lot of horses for that game. And then I've got some jumping horses.
So you supply the whole game, do you?
Well, you yourself need quite a few horses.
Yeah, if you're going to invite your friends over to play.
She has a lot of horses.
I got a lot of horses.
She's got a lot of horses.
No kidding. You guys really are heart to heart. Coming up next, Lionel Stander's going to be here. He plays Max, the heart's loyal butler. And remember the dog Freeway? He's going to be here, too. He's probably the only freeway in L.A. that didn't fall apart in the earthquake. We'll see how he's holding up. Stick around. We'll be back. To heart reunion here today, kids. Robert Wagner and Stephanie Powers have been sharing their heartfelt stories, and with us now is their co-star Lionel Stander and the family pooch Freeway Jr. Freeway Jr., how did you meet this kid?
I met him in Rome when he was doing a It Takes a Thief. Is that right?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah? And you were doing that, too? What were you doing in Rome?
I was making spaghetti westerns and whatever films would have me.
Really? Because you were blacklisted in the 50s,
That's
yeah?
right.
What do you have to say about all of that, big guy?
It's unbelievable. It's ridiculous. When you look back on it, there's no reason for me to be blacklisted.
Yeah. Yeah. He's sort of a father figure to you, yes?
Yes, you know, right? Vicky, it's so... Steph and I, you know, are so very fortunate to have Lionel with us, because when you can have an actor, you know, a really fine character actor like Lionel, I mean, he's gold in our bank, you know, because when he looks at us and says he loves us, that's a home run, you know?
Yeah. Ever since Heart to Heart, I've been saying we need to find a Max. I say that all the time to Al. We need to find a Max. How did the role of Max come about?
It was always there.
Well, yeah, it was written in there. But as Steph told you before, we never really had a chance to reveal it as much as we've had now, because Max really was the one that found me in this orphanage and took me out and put me under his wing, and he's the one that shot the arrow for Jennifer and I to be married, and he felt that she was the right girl for me, and so he's...
And you say that Lionel's a father figure to you, yes, in real life?
Absolutely. Oh, yes.
How so?
Yes.
Oh. Andre is like a son to me. A son who I adore.
Yeah.
Because he's impossible just as charming off screen as he is on.
Yeah. And what is the father figure thing here? What is it you love about Lionel?
Well, Lionel is just a very solid and bright and intelligent man, and
He's also a great person for the underdog. And Lionel has, you know, there's many, many things that people don't realize about Lionel. I mean, there was one time when Lionel had probably produced more Broadway shows than anybody.
Really?
He was out there as an actor and as a Broadway producer. When he was blacklisted, he went and decided he wasn't going to get him down, and he went to the stock market, and he sat a seat on which stock exchange?
Was it which stock exchange?
Wall Street.
On Wall Street. On Wall Street. A seat on Wall Street.
Yeah.
He decided to become to have a seat on Wall Street. He became, yeah, became a stockbroker. Pretty good, huh?
Yeah. It's all right.
Yeah. Have you been as lucky with the stocks?
I was very lucky. I made more money as a stockbroker than I ever did as an actor.
I need to talk to you about the show. Now, this is Freeway Junior, huh?
Yes,
this is son of Freeway?
This is the son of Freeway.
Old Freeway passed away.
What happened to Old Freeway?
Old Freeway got old, really old. Really.
He wasn't
a youngster anyway when we had him, you know.
Yeah, Freeway was 8 years old when we cast him. Mm-hmm. And the show was on for 5 years, so he was 13 when it came to an end. And, you know, he's in dog heaven.
So this is is this a direct descendant of Freeway?
This is, yeah.
What's his real name, this guy?
Harry.
Harry's his real name. The other dog's name was Charlie.
What are you doing? Charlie and Harry.
See,
huh?
And we keep him with us, you know, all the time. I mean, he hangs around with us, and we, you know, Stephanie's so great with him, and you know, now Freeway Senior was kind of difficult because he wasn't trained as well as Harry. So the trainer would say, you know, sit down, stand up, roll over. And I'd be making love to Stephanie. I thought he was talking to me.
This can be a big problem.
Yeah.
Don't you guys go away. We have to take a break, but we're going to find out what famous movie star helped RJ and even insisted that he get top billing. And who says Hollywood is such a cruel place? We'll find out all about it. Boomer. With the cast of Heart to Heart, Stephanie Powers is here, Robert Wagner, Lionel Stander, and Freeway Jr. Mr. Wagner, we have a clip of you from God knows when.
Oh, God.
That I guess prompted Spencer Tracy to just absolutely know that you were a star. Do you know which movie that is?
No, I don't.
Well, let's take a look at it.
What's the matter?
Nothing.
A minute ago, you were thinking something. What were you thinking? About your father? Your brothers? That when you helped me, you turned against them? Is that what you were thinking?
I'm sorry. I'm acting like a baby.
Well, that's all you are. You're just a kid.
Oh, look who's talking.
You know, all I have to do is yell, and he'll find you and take you home. You're going home with me.
What about your folks, your mother? Maybe she won't want me.
They'll want you.
Yes?
Yes, that was Terry Moore.
And he saw you, and Spencer Tracy saw you in that?
He saw me in that film, and he said that he'd like to have me play his son in a picture that he did called Broken Lance. And,
did you see
the film? So it was a great opportunity for me, Vicki. It was a tremendous opportunity.
Yeah.
And, that was the beginning of my friendship with him, and that was a really, really the most wonderful and fortunate thing that could have happened to me, because he put his arm around me and he said, you can be somebody. And everybody needs that in their life.
Yeah,
you know?
But oh, what a wonderful guy to do it. Can you take us back to the first time you ever laid eyes on Natalie Wood, and what did you think?
Well, the first time I ever saw Natalie, she was a child actress at Fox. And I remember seeing her in the hallway, and she said to me, she didn't say to me, she said to her mother, she said, you know, I'd like to marry him someday.
Really? How old was she at the time?
Oh, she's about 10.
Really?
Yeah, lucky thing for me, huh?
So when did something happen?
Well, I took her out. As a matter of fact, I took her to a film. The first time I took her out, she was 18 years old, and I took her to the premiere of a picture called The Mountain, which was a picture that I made with Spencer Tracy, another film I made with him. Uh-huh. And we went out to that, and I took her out on her 18th birthday.
What was your first impression of her?
Oh, I thought she was absolutely great. She thought I was an old, you know, fogey kind of, you know, because she was into all of the young actors, you know, Jimmy Dean and all of these young kids that were with the, you know, the Actors Studio. And she worked very hard. You know, she used to go back east and work at the studio and observe and everything. She was really very much into acting. And I was, you know, quite a bit older than she was. And so I was running around with an older crowd. She kind of thought that I was sort of, you know, over the hill.
Really?
It took me a while to change that.
You know, the gals out here are thinking you're pretty darn cute. And stick around out there because we've got a lot more to talk about. Don't go away. We're going to get questions here in a minute. I am back with one of America's most romantic TV couples, Heart to Hearts, Robert Wagner and Stephanie Powers, along with their loyal man, Friday, and real-life pal, Lionel Stander. We have a photo we found of you, RJ, that I think you should probably explain to everybody. We're kind of curious about it. what is that, hon?
That's when I was in drag.
Well, we can see that.
And I played a princess with Stephanie.
I see. Okay?
And I am telling you, I was dying with those high heel shoes on. And the bra and the earrings and the hair. Uh-huh. What you women go through.
I know, it's not an easy thing. I don't think men appreciate it.
The earrings, he was always complaining about the earrings. Isn't it funny?
Yeah,
well, the earrings.
Well, you're not
they
used
hurt.
To that.
And it was kind of hard, you know, because I didn't want to go over the top. So I'd stay with Stephanie all the time, and she'd say, you know, calm down. Because, you know, I'd walk out, and the guys would start whistling at me, you know, and give me a lot.
Yes.
And I'd start,
hard not to get carried away.
I'd start camping it up, you know.
Yeah.
And I'd start fooling around, and she'd come over to me and say, now, take it easy. Cool.
They are great legs, though, you know. They really
good
are.
Good legs,
they're
too.
Thicker than mine.
We have a clip, too, from one of my favorite shows that I think we should take a look at. It takes a thief.
Oh.
Remember that one? Let's look.
Can you tell me how to approach Miss Halls?
I advise you not to approach her.
Oh, you don't think, I mean, well, she's a great scout, but as far as anything personal, she does the cooking.
Yeah?
Well, I like to put on an apron and putter around the kitchen.
You cook?
Eggs are my specialty. Scrambled sunny side, coddled. I guess I've been behind bars so long that, well, not too much turns me on.
Cuddled eggs turn you on?
Eggs Benedict. They're more exciting. I guess there's nothing better than good friends, good books, and good food. What else can a man ask for?
Oh, nothing. Nothing else.
That's a two-part question. Heart to Heart is going to premiere tomorrow, and they're going to do Movie of the Week. Are they going to do more than one movie? And the other question is, do you prefer doing a Movie of the Week, or do you like the old grind of weekly series?
Well, now, you're not actually premiering tomorrow night. This is the second of...
This is number two of four.
Of four. Oh,
yeah. I wish you wouldn't say this is number two.
Not while the dog's sitting on your lap, I guess. Does he know that trick? And what about the weekly grind of doing a series? Do you miss it? Would you ever go back to it?
The difficult thing is it's, you hear everybody say this, but the difficult thing is the writing. You know, if you're doing 22-hour programs per year, it's so difficult to keep it alive. And the writers that you have for the first season, if you're a success, they generally go on to produce other shows or do their own things, and you get another group of writers. Those writers
can only make you a failure. They can't make you a success because you've already been a success. So they don't feel that they're contributing very much. And so, you know, it starts to go downhill. And it's a really, really, that's the hardest part. The hours of
finding good writing.
But the writing and maintaining the writing is really difficult.
Question?
Yes, this question is for all three of you. What do you like acting better on, film or television?
Films or television?
Well, there's also the theater, you know.
You like theater best, Stephanie?
I like a good role in whatever medium. And they're all equally interesting as long as the parts are good.
You know, it's very much the same, film and television. And, you know, it's all projected and it's done rather the same way. I prefer working in television myself because the film takes so long.
It's a little bit quicker.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Well, greetings from Detroit. When I flew out, it was 58 degrees below zero wind chill factor, so it's nice to be here. Anyway, my question, my favorite all-time, I'm sorry, is It Takes a Thief. And I was just wondering, are they going to syndicate that thing, or are they going to put it so we can see? I haven't seen it since I was a kid, and I was hoping that it'd be out.
Thank you very much. I love that part, Alexander Monday. And I think it's in syndication now. They bring it out periodically.
Well, it's not back in Detroit yet, so I haven't seen
it. Well, you call your local station and ask them what the hell they're doing.
Thanks.
I'll call the station and ask them what the hell they're doing.
Who is running this damn station, and where is It Takes the Thief? We got to take a break. We'll be back in a minute.
I'm really glad you like it. Thank you.
Questions. The answer to one of those questions is yes, he is a fabulous kisser. I would like to thank my guests today, Robert Wagner, Stephanie Powers, and Lionel Sander. Be sure you catch their new movie, Home is Where the Heart Is. It airs tomorrow night at 9 p.m. as part of the NBC Friday Night Mystery Series. Have a great day. We love you. Bye-bye. Thanks.
Hotel accommodations provided by the Mondrian Hotel, Sunset Strip Chic Hotel, featuring panoramic views from every suite, nightly entertainment, and cutting-edge California cuisine. ELS Limousine, serving Los Angeles and New York for over 14 years, can provide sedans and limousines for every special event. ELS Limousine, cars to the stars. Thank you, I'm Madmans. If you like what I'm wearing, kids, go get it there.
Hi, this is Sally Thornier. Coming up today at 5, we'll tell you why some old books may start disappearing in libraries across the country.